Hey guys, Dagan here from PMTV UK, and welcome to another episode of Rock and Shop, a show where we chat to musicians about what they're up to, the gear they use, and why they use it. Unfortunately, COVID-19 is still a thing here in the UK, but thanks to the wonders of technology, I can still chat to people, and today I'm chatting to the fantastic bass player that is Olivia Thompson. Liv, thank you so much for joining me here today and taking time out of your busy scheduling chatting to us. How's it going?
Thank you. I'm good. How are you? Thanks for having me.
No, it's great to have you. Thank you so much. So the people that don't know out there, Liv is an extremely accomplished session musician, both on bass and other instruments. You've performed out with Becky Hill, Little Mix, amongst others. Where did your love for the instrument start?
Yeah, so it started quite late on, to be honest. So I started about 6 or 7 on the flute.
Right.
At school, we were quite keen on everyone learning instruments.
Yeah.
So I picked the flute, joined a few orchestras, got on with that okay. It wasn't my favourite, like, it was okay, like, one of those things. Like, I practiced, like, before the lesson. It was, like, trying to get my scales together. Yeah, so I continued with that. Didn't take it too seriously, like, it was just for fun. And then I got through ABRSM, like the graded sort of system. Got through those. So I was about 14 at this point. So I'd got through the flute, thought like maybe I'll give something else a go. Like I've got a few years of school left. So my mum actually suggested the bass. I wasn't like interested at all. But she was like, oh, that'd be cool. Maybe like that'd be a fun thing to do.
Yeah.
So I was like, sure, yeah, let's try that. So went and bought a bass. I went to the local music shop and picked out a Yamaha BB44, which not a lot of people play, but saw it and was like, yeah.
Great bass.
So, yeah, so bought that, started up, and then that was it. just really enjoyed it from there.
Was it your idea as a youngster to start an instrument, or be a flute or anything like that? Or were you kind of influenced by music you were a fan of, or how did that come about?
Yeah, well, my dad is actually really into music, so he has like a record collection of like thousands, like so many. He's been collecting since he was a kid. So his like love for music really, so he'd blast it out on a Saturday, like full volume,
nice.
It all out. So it was always part of like my life from being really small. But I wouldn't say like I was really interested in learning anything like until I started bass really.
Yeah.
So it was just something that was like recommended in school to like play instruments. But it's when I started the bass is when like the influences came after.
Yeah.
So started it was like, yeah, why not? And then yeah, really got into it.
So who were those influences then? Once you started getting into bass, were you interested in art like bands as a whole or specific artists?
I would say like my first like biggest influence was like Maiden.
Yeah.
Was like the massive one. So when I started lessons, my teacher like sort of connected all of the students. So he connected me with like a few of the players and they were really into like Maiden, like Megadeth, stuff like that. So I was like, cool.
That's
like,
quite intense for a bass player going from Nought to Iron Maiden.
I know, But they were such a massive influence, like and learning their stuff by ear. is like super challenging. And yeah, like maybe like a year into me starting, I was literally just learning like Maiden tunes by ear, like Megadeth tunes, like every day. It was a bit wild. Like,
so it was more of a rock beginning then for your bass
starting
out.
Absolutely.
When did it start to turn into, was it the music changing around you, or was it you being like, I want to try other things and delve out into other genres? How did that kind of come about?
Yeah, so it was pretty much like rock, like metal stuff up until I went to uni. So I was played in like some rock and metal bands like around my town and stuff like that. I also played in a function band as well, like around my town. So that was a massive help as well. And that was like all sorts of like the classic function.
Yeah, I'm in a function band. I totally know what you mean.
Yeah, it's great. Like it's so much fun, like to get to play all those genres.
Yeah, so that's fun.
Yeah, it's great. So played in that. So that sort of like opened the scope for anything. And then started applying for unis, played a Maiden tune as my entrance piece for all of the unis. But it was like at uni where like other genres like soul and like funk and stuff, like I really got exposed to. So at this point, it's just, everything.
Yeah, it's all genres of, with amazing bass playing, going from the amazing stuff of Iron Maiden to funk and soul, because some of the bass lines are more prominent and memorable than the vocal lines or the guitar lines. It's the bass that makes that kind of genre a thing, so it's obviously going to naturally fall into those guys.
Yeah, for sure.
So was it from university you started thinking, right, I want to do this full time, I'm going to concentrate all my energy on doing this, and that's when you started playing more session work and starting to work with other people, or how did that happen?
Yeah, well, it was, I guess it was in school, really, like once I started learning at 15, and then after a year or so, my bass teacher at the time put me in touch with, so in the town that I'm from, it's quite like a small community of players. So there's a few function bands, like a few of the younger guys are doing bands. But with the function bands, it's sort of like one sort of group of musicians. They don't like swap and change because there aren't really enough. So once you're like in them, that's like your thing that you do. So when I was 16, I was maybe 17, like around that age, my teacher said, my friends are in a function band, like the bass player's quit. Are you like happy to do this? So was up for that. Was like, yeah, let's do it. They sent me all the tunes through like a CD just to listen to, like no music or anything. I think the gig was in a week, I'm pretty sure. It was like, so here's the set, like here are the harmonies. I'd never sang.
That was like, your first singing job in a function band, and here are the harmonies.
Yeah. I was like, okay. I was like, I can't really sing, but he was like, no, it's fine. Like, you'll be fine.
Just rock it.
So he gave me the highest ones because the rest were guys. Yeah. So sent me the CD of the BVs and the bass for a week. I was like, cool. So learnt those super fast, learnt the BVs. And on this gig that we did, I think, because I've mentioned it to my family, obviously, I was like, oh, I'm like playing these gigs now. Yeah. Everybody came down, like my whole like extended family. I was like, oh. So that was like my first gig, which was really in at the deep end, like playing for a year.
Yeah.
So from that point, I was gigging with them like every weekend, pretty much without fail. So at that point, I was like, okay, like I can really like take this seriously now. Yeah. Like I'm gigging, like making money. So yeah, that's when I decided to go to uni really, and didn't really think about it. Like, didn't have like another plan. I was like, yeah, like this is great.
Yeah. So there's never like a 14-year-old live thinking, I'm going to be a rock star and do this. You kind of just fell into it and was like, wow, this is actually, I can make money and get a career from doing what I enjoy and playing music.
Totally, yeah, like there was no like interest in it before. Like I like enjoyed music, I appreciated music, but it's when I started playing the bass and started gigging, I was like, no,
this is for me.
Happening. Nice. Yeah, definitely.
So we haven't actually said, but you did music, I'm guessing, at uni.
Yes, yeah, I studied at the RNCM in Manchester.
Very nice. Is that where
it's a hard decision because there's so many that are amazing. Yeah. It's like, yeah.
Is that where you kind of met the people and kind of evolved into performing with, well, up and down the UK with big artists?
Well, yeah, I mean, I started posting stuff on Instagram actually when I got to uni to try and like market myself a bit more.
Yeah.
So I did like gigs with like local people in Manchester, like local artists and stuff. And it was kind of more through like the networking on like social media and stuff that really helped that, like just constantly, you know, like pushing out stuff, like getting in contact that way. So yeah, like it was gigging a lot in Manchester at first, like the first 2 years, and then started branching more out.
I mean, Instagram and social media is the best thing in the world for an up-and-coming musician out there, especially when, like yourself, you've got the talent, and if you push the network in as well, it'll come to you, won't it?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, especially if you like pushing stuff out there, like eventually something will come. Like the more you put out there, like you can't keep pushing out and nothing comes. Like if you keep pushing out, eventually something's gonna come.
So that's how you got to where you are today. And recently you played the Virgin, what's it called? The Virgin Money Utility Arena here in Newcastle, where I'm based right now with Becky Hill. How was that for you? Because that was the world's first socially distanced festival.
Yeah.
And everyone here in Newcastle was like, is this going to work? Then we saw people in America kicking off thinking, what the hell are they doing over in the UK? Yeah. It looked a lot of fun. How was it for you to be on stage and see people? Was it weird or was it just like everyone's vibing, everyone's having a great time? How was it?
When I like when we got the call through, I thought like this is going to be the weirdest thing ever. Yeah. Like everyone's going to be all over the place, mm-hmm. like miles apart. It's going to be so weird. Like there's going to be like a really weird atmosphere. It's going to be weird. But when we stepped out, because it's like it's covering such a big area.
Yeah.
So from like your perspective, it's not, no one's really apart. Like there's all like pens and stuff.
Yeah.
With like groups of six. Yeah, no, it was great. Like it was the same atmosphere as any other gig because everyone's so excited to be there and everyone's like vibing with you. Yeah, it was great.
I was thinking so that because everyone who I know have went to watch a gig say it's exactly the same. You totally forget once you're there, this you're in a essentially like a little pen from like a farm show.
Yeah.
You're in a little pen and everyone on stage, I'm guessing, like you said, just totally forget that's the case and just rock out, I guess.
Yeah, definitely. Because it's like such a vast space. You can't really see like the division. No, it was so much fun. I feel so lucky to have done it. Like I know that it was because it got shut down, I think, quite soon after. Is it like a few days after?
It did, yeah. It's a weird thing, but I'm so pleased it was a thing and it's got to be a great feeling being a part of it because I can't imagine that ever happening again. So it's quite cool to be a thing.
I know. I mean, I feel like they should do that from now. Like if everything's going to take so long to get back to normal, I think that is a great solution. Mm. Like I had family that came and they said like they felt really safe. Like it worked well. It was well organized. Yeah. So I think they should do more. It would be a shame if that was the only one. But fingers crossed. Gets out.
So. Right, so that's the gigs. Let's talk about you and bass. Besides Maiden, who are your favourite bass players these days? Who do you look up to? Who do you vibe off?
Maiden obviously had like a massive, maybe not so visible now, but they definitely had a massive influence on me. Yeah. Like, so important to me. But I'd say nowadays, I guess, because I'm trying to do more of like the session thing, I suppose like massive influences now are like Pino.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, just the best. Like I've made this playlist of like everything he played on to like transcribe it all. It took me weeks to like.
Why on earth would you do that to yourself? I want to transcribe everything Pino Palatino's ever done. That'll be a good 6 months.
Well, because there's some stuff that you didn't even like. You don't realize he's on like the Adele stuff, like Kimbra stuff, and like you can't necessarily hear it's him, which is what makes it so great. But yeah. I was like, if I really need, like, want to appreciate him, I have to like go through everything he's ever done on a playlist, like transcribe it. Yeah, which a mammoth task.
It is a mammoth task. So you say Pino's your main inspiration these days.
Yeah, and there's a guy called Sheree Reed as well, who he plays for Corey Henry and like loads of other people. So like Chaka Khan, etc. Like he's another guy, just goes on and on. Yeah, he is such a massive influence. So he came into the RNCM a few times for like a masterclass and he plays like along with like even just Spotify, like he opens up Spotify, like says like, what does everyone want to hear? Takes requests, plays along to Spotify, which shouldn't sound incredible because, you know, it's like a phone plugged in, but it's like next level, like magic, like the room just fills with like this tone, like it's wild.
Fantastic.
Next level. So definitely him. There's so many. I'd say those are like the two now that I'm really like reading up on, like focusing on, but
it's a nice eclectic mix, I guess. Like you're taking musicians who do one thing really well as people like Pino and him who are versatile as hell, but you manage to fit them all into your playing and be unique for yourself. With versatility being a subject now, I've seen you play 5-string basses. How did that come about? Was it a thing from back in the function days where you can just be a bit more free, or is it a personal preference? Why the 5-string?
Yeah, I mean, that was definitely a plus point, which I realised later on, like for function tunes, like a 5-string is so useful. Yeah. So that's definitely a plus. I don't know, you know, like why. I think I just kind of fancied like that lower like tone, I think. Yeah. I don't think it necessarily came from anywhere, but I did see someone playing. So the Musicman that I have, it's got like the two pickups, which is quite weird for a Musicman. But I saw someone playing it on a gig, which was also 5-string. It sounded so great. Yeah. I was like,
a great
that's what I
basis.
Need. Yeah, I was like trying to decide what I was going to go for. Like I was leaning towards like a Fender bass because I was sort of, the Yamaha was like incredible. But I kind of needed a second one. Like, I was gigging so much at the time, I was like, it's probably safe to have spare, like, just in case. So I was looking around, was leaning towards Fender, but then saw somebody play this and was like, yeah, that's exactly what. And the low B is really what made me think, like, yeah, I really need this. So after getting that, I just took to it really naturally. Like, I know a lot of people are like, not, it takes them like a while to get into it. But yeah, the low B felt like better for me than like a four string. Like, I kind of struggle with four strings now because it's like not there. Yeah, but yeah, no, that bass was like best purchase.
Very nice. Ever. So that's your main bass, the double humbucker Musicman.
Yeah. That is my bass.
How many basses have you got on your How many basses have you got on your arsenal? Have you got a couple of backups, or have you still got the Yamaha?
Yes, I do. I still have that. That has served me so well. Like, it's great. It's never, nothing has ever gone wrong with it. It's, yeah, it's perfect. But this is my main one, yeah. I also have an acoustic Fender, which I use for like acoustic gigs, which sounds great. And then I have my synth bass here, which I use on gigs also. It's kind of a 50-50 split at this point with gigs. It's usually like synth bass and electric.
Yeah, I wanted to talk about that actually, because you do play a lot of synths and whatnot. Do you find it a natural transition? Because it is somewhat of the lower end of the register. Is it a natural transition for yourself?
Yeah, so I think it was the Little Mix gig, which was the first gig where it was like requested to bring one, which is kind of like standard now. But I didn't have one at that point. So I rushed myself to PMT and bought a Novation bass station. So like messed about with that, but it was fairly like natural. I use my ears for most things.
Yeah, because it is just kind of groove and rhythm and stuff, isn't it? So it's perfect.
Definitely. So it was quite natural, for sure. And now it's like 50% of what I play on gigs now.
So, what are your go-to synths?
Well, I'd say this Moog is like the best, really, that you can get in terms of like playing synth bass. So this is brilliant. And then I've got the Novation, which is like a lot smaller and lighter. So for like traveling gigs, or if there's not that much room, like I'll take that. That sounds great too. Although Moog have brought out like a smaller one of these, so I do have my eye on that, because this it sounds phenomenal. But definitely those two.
Cool. So these interviews, the little rock and shops I do, I always like to get into the nitty-gritty with what people use as well, because people do want to know about that kind of stuff. What kind of amps do you use? Strings, plectrums, pedals, what's your usual go-to rig?
In terms of strings, I was using on the Yamaha, I've used Dunlop Super Brights, like always. Mm-hmm. But when I got this new bass, it just had the regular slinkies fitted, like the 50 ones, I think. Sounded like perfect. So I was like, there's no need to change these. So I've since switched over to those. They're perfect for that bass. Like, they complement it so well. And in terms of amps, so I have a Mark bass down here, which is a super light. For like traveling gigs, where I've got to like lug it on the train. that sounds great. This is since, it's not been out in a while, so it's since retrained as a table for the time being. But this sounds great. And then I have an Aguilar behind me, which is really heavy, but I'll use that where I can, if I can, have it.
I think I've seen you use the Aguilar on your YouTube channel. And for people that don't know, Liv has an amazing YouTube channel where she plays covers and whatnot. do you use that on the YouTube channel? Because I think I've seen it.
I do. And it's linked up to a tone hammer as well, like the tone hammer amp head, which is brilliant. I use that on everything. I use that with the Mark bass as well. Like, sounds great. On my pedal board, I've got another tone hammer, which is also a
Can't
DI.
Enough tone hammers, I guess.
Yeah, no, they're great. So good. And then I like to keep it fairly simple, actually. So I've got an OC2 on here. I sort of have like a main setup, and then if I'm going to a gig, I'll like chuck some more pedals like in my bag just in case. So on the main, I have an OC2, OC3, and then a compressor, like Boss Tuner, a Cali compressor, and an Aguilar Agro, overdrive. And then I'll chuck like an MXR like envelope filter in my bag, like some dark glass stuff. So just in case, some things like requested. But beyond the point of like octaves, overdrives, like fuzz and stuff.
That's like your standard go-to.
Like, Yeah, and then if it gets past that point where it, you know, I'll use the synth, because that tends to give like a cleaner tone, like if you like really pile it on like the pedal. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I like to keep it simple, but yeah, that's pretty much what I've got going on.
Cool. I mean, do you use this whole setup when you record the videos yourself? I've noticed you put a few up recently during this whole COVID-19 thing. Have you been using this time to hone your craft or write your own stuff or just genuinely rest, because musicians don't get often get a chance to rest?
I know. What are you doing? It's weird. I don't like it. Like, I don't like resting.
It feels like you should be doing something and you feel guilty for not doing something.
Yeah, no, it sucks. Yeah, it's a weird time. But I'm lucky enough to be at home right now, like back in my hometown. So I actually just graduated 2 months ago.
Congratulations.
From uni. Thank you. Bit of an anticlimax, but you know, what can we do? So graduated 2 months ago. So moved back home, like gearing up to move to London. And then obviously this happened. But luckily I'm back home, so it's nice. So I get to, you know, quarantine here. Honestly, just like practicing as much as I can.
Yeah.
Trying to get everything together that's maybe a little bit like not great just before things start again.
Absolutely, home in your craft, you can get back out there all guns blazing.
Totally, which I'm lucky enough to be able to do, thankfully, but yes.
Cool. What have you got coming up in the future once all this hopefully passes ASAP?
Yeah, I hope so. Well, when this sort of hit, I was with Becky and the rest of the crew on, so it was actually my first UK and European tour.
Yeah.
So we were going with the script, supporting them. So this all kicked off when we were like maybe 2/3 of the way through. So came home from that.
Were you in the UK at the time, or were you away, or?
Yeah, we were in Ireland, I think, just about to head to Newcastle.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that is hopefully going to be rescheduled. I mean, we're so lucky that we got 2/3 of it done. Like, I feel so bad for the people that were like gearing up to go. So hopefully reschedule that. Just rescheduling, pretty much. Like Becky's stuff rescheduled. Like, I also play with a rapper called Barney Fletcher, who's sick. So next with him, hopefully. Like last year we just did the festival run, so like Reading and Leeds, like the Lollapalooza in Paris, like all that kind of stuff. So fingers crossed this summer we'll be doing some stuff. I don't know about that, but yeah,
hopefully by next year it's all finished. But I want to end on a high as well and talk about what is your favorite gig you played and why. It's a tough one, but
that's such a difficult question. I'd probably, I think there's two, to be honest, if that's okay. So I think Strictly with Little Mix was probably like the best thing ever, I would say.
It did look amazing.
Yeah, that was great. Like everybody was super nice. Like that was like my first like proper gig, really, like of that sort of thing. It was, yeah, so great. Everyone was so, like, lovely. So that was a cool thing. And then also I did Live Lounge with Becky Hill. So that's I've cool. always wanted to do live lounges, always. Like, I've been saying for years, like, I really want to do one. Like, I can't wait. Just, like, putting it out, like, into the world.
Is it as cool as what it looks like? Because I've watched loads of live lounges in my time. Is it as cool as, like, to be there as it is to watch?
It is cool. It never looks like how it looks though. Like in the, do you know what I mean? Like when something's like videoed and then you get there, it doesn't look like it at all.
Yeah.
But it was super cool. Like nice. It was a lot bigger than, because it looks quite like.
It does look a bit cramped, yeah.
Yeah, no, it was, yeah. It was a lot bigger than it looks. Yeah, it was super cool. Yeah. It was
nice
great.
One. Yeah. Cool. Well, thank you so much for your time, Liv. If you want to let the people know, where can they find you online? All your social medias and stuff if you fancy.
Yeah, so my Instagram is Liv Thompson Bass. Everything is Liv Thompson Bass, actually. So it's all linked on my Instagram, but yeah, that username is like through everything. So yeah, that's where you can find me.
Fantastic, it's been a pleasure. One final question as well. Do you fancy a little jam?
Yes, I would love that.
Awesome, let's do it. Thank you, Liv. Cheers.
Thank you so much.